Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Berger Varsity Football House on the campus of Lafayette College in Easton, Pennsylvania. It is National Signing Day. It is always a very exciting day here in the Lafayette Football House. And I'm Gary Laubach, along with Mike Joseph. We are the guys up in the booth that bring you the Lafayette Leopards every year when they're playing tough football down on the field. I am with head coach Frank Tavani, and this is always a big, big day. 26 new recruits have already signed on this National Letter of Intent Day, National Letter Signing Day. So it's going to be a good signing year for Lafayette College. But Frank, I don't want to talk about that yet. We have not had a chance to sit down one time and talk a little bit about this, the championship of the Patriot League last season. You've had some time to reflect on the year. It was, without question, one of the strangest years you probably have ever coached. But has it all sunk in, and have you figured out exactly how it all got accomplished?
Well, Gary, it gets accomplished with great young men. Our kids showed great resiliency, our staff. It's credit to everybody around the program. As you know, things were looking not very good, and we just kept saying, hey, we're coming back to work every day. Mm-hmm. We're going to keep working. We're going to keep battling. We knew we were better than what the results were showing. We had a fight. We had some things we had to get over, injuries. And the interesting thing was for the first time I've ever experienced, we got healthier as the season went on. I kept counting more and more people at practice every day the second half of the season, when finally, the week before the Lehigh game, mysteriously, they were real healthy.
Yeah.
And, all those things factored into helping us win the Patriot League Championship, but a real tribute to our young men.
What I find interesting as we get ready for today is that a year ago, some of the kids that really were critical to the success of this year's football team, a year ago, were sitting at home signing a letter of intent, because there were a number of freshmen that got plenty of time, and I guess the best example of that would be Drew Reed.
Well, certainly, without a doubt, Drew waited his turn and got his opportunity, and certainly seized the moment. It's a great example of patience, but still believing in yourself, mm-hmm. and knowing when you get the call that you're ready to go and perform, which is what he did, and we did. I forget right now what the number was, but we lettered quite a few freshmen with special teams and contributions in other ways. So this freshman class certainly has made an impact.
Mike, I know you've had a couple of weeks now to look over the potential Lafayette people that are going to be coming on campus to play football. Can you give us a general overview? Because Frank's sometimes a little modest and doesn't always want to talk about all the individuals. But without talking about individuals, because you and I will do that a little bit later on
sure.
in the day, just an overview of how successful you think this recruiting season has been.
Well, let's look at it as the second year of scholarship football play in the Patriot League, and second year of being able to give out scholarships. And I think the coaches were probably a little more comfortable mm-hmm. with how they went about the routine, how they brought the kids in, families, and all that type of stuff. But I think the class is outstanding. And if you look at the class, you break it down kind of positionally, as we will, just those skill kids that they're bringing in, the wide receivers, the tight ends. Now look at the kids they have to basically replace. Mark mm-hmm, Ross, mm-hmm, obviously mm-hmm. you look right at Mark Ross, you look at Brandon Hall, you look at some of the linemen up front, Brad Borman, Pat Crosby, those type of kids offensively. So I think it's an outstanding class, and it shows where the level of athleticism is coming from. These kids, they just get bigger, they get stronger, and just for example, the wide receivers, I think they average about 6'3". Mm-hmm. So you can see mm-hmm. the size. Now, how do you match up defensively with that? So now you got to go out and get yourself some 6'2" corners that play long, and Lafayette has done that as well. So I think it's an exceptional class. You're going to see some great linebackers. You're going to see some outstanding linemen, which probably wasn't a huge thing for Lafayette in that they brought in a few last year, but I am sure Frank and the guys are glad it's over, but now they're into junior recruiting, so it just starts over again.
Frank, as we look at the recruitment, 10 different states, and you went as far west as California, Arizona, Colorado, as far north as Michigan. Obviously, in the east, you've got 10 kids out of Pennsylvania alone, your normal numbers out of New Jersey, New York, but you really have expanded the horizons in the last bunch of years.
Well, certainly, the internet helps quite a bit, mm-hmm. especially with mm-hmm. the huddle being as big as it is with everyone, or if a young man's name, anybody can sit at home, and people do it now. Our alums are watching these kids on film before we even know they're coming. I'm reading about, somebody's coming and hasn't committed yet, So everybody has access to this stuff, and then if it's not on there, it's on YouTube. So you have an opportunity to see a lot more people, and people are sending stuff to you. We're certainly scouring our regional area the way mm-hmm. we do physically, but we had a few kids that we were interested in California, so we just Mickey Fine was finished with his area here, which is how we do it, and then he went out.
I heard he went out 2 weeks early to surf.
Really
and
with
the bays.
Well, he would have liked to, I'm sure. These trips are rough now. You're on a plane longer than you're making the visit, and especially when you go to California. So he spent about 2.5 days there, and we ended up actually, we offered 3 and 2 are coming. So, we feel real good about that. But you can go anywhere now. I mean, you've got this kind of education and this facility, and then you're talking about a full scholarship. Give or take about $250,000 it's worth over a 4-year period. It's a pretty good situation to come to Lafayette College.
Go ahead.
And Coach, you did very well locally. You like to have that nice blend, and there's a bunch of kids that just from the area, which is a big part of what you do and staying in the area, and that's a big, I thought that was a big get as well this year.
Well, we had some stronger interest there, and this year, I think as opposed to some other years, we recruit the area very hard. In fact, it's the first thing that we do. We already know pretty much going into next season who the local kids are, and we certainly attended to that. But it's not as easy as you think. A lot of young men do not want to go to school in their backyard. So, again, any given year, it depends on the individual and the family and everything. But the bottom line is a lot of them look at the education and what we have to offer here. And some of them, despite being local, haven't even seen it. Facility. Mm-hmm. Unless you've been in the Easton Peaburg game, you might not even been here. So people come down and it's a lot different than maybe they knew.
And it's always a little easier to recruit when you're bringing that trophy with you as well.
Well, it certainly helps. I don't know so much that it helps you, and some would say that it may hinder you some, that people think, well, they're really good, we'll go somewhere else that's trying to get better. The bottom line is the work's still the same. The recruiting is so competitive. You've got to work every bit as hard, and it's just got a bigger smile on your face because you got that trophy, and unfortunately we got to wait till April to shine that big ring around. But we'll get to that in May recruiting.
Frank, one of our viewers on the internet asked us to ask you about the process, and Mike has already alluded to the fact that you're already looking at juniors who are playing football this coming season. So let's talk a little bit about the process, how you gather up the names, how you gather up the prospects, how you eventually wheedle it down, and how does all of that happen?
Well, everyone, all colleges and universities subscribe to different services, as we do as well. You utilize services in the areas that you think you're going to be the most helpful to you. Certainly, we are a regional school. We certainly are known nationally, but we're certainly known more regionally. So you got to take care of your backyard, and we make sure we do that, a 3-hour to 4-hour, 5-hour, including Pittsburgh. But Pennsylvania, New Jersey are hotbeds of football, and you have to recruit them and make sure you don't miss anyone. And then, of course, our bordering states of New York, Maryland, Delaware, those places, you have to physically get to those. Then from there, you have to make some decisions, which we have, in areas. And quite frankly, something as simple as places where there are direct flights from ABE Airport, to make it easy getting here. People enjoy getting off of the flight and 12 minutes later are standing on your campus, as opposed to Newark where, it's an hour, Philly an hour and a half. So we try to recruit those people, have the availability for their families and stuff to be able to get into ABE. Sounds like a little thing, but has worked well because we have direct flights to Atlanta and Florida and all the places that we've come to be known. So we've become a lot more East Coast. Florida had been a huge state. Somebody asked me the other day, geez, that seems to be slowing down. Well, there's a lot of reasons things change. First of all, there's a lot more options down there than the big three that it used to be. There's a lot of other programs, coming up.
And everybody wants to Florida.
Everybody. And, and again, people come up here in the winter and you think they want to leave Florida. So, that's sometimes weather's going to hurt you on those official visits. So,
no, take a look outside.
But, it's a lot of things. And now with the internet and the way people sell themselves, and they're smart, it's so easy to market yourself and get information to us. And we're sitting here looking at FilmCon. Everything, and believe me, it's thousands of them. Everyone that comes in gets looked at by somebody. My younger guys spend most of their days and nights and then seeing, is it worth it? To move on, and we always grab some, and that's how a lot of these outlying areas we found.
That was another question we got on the internet. We're trying to answer as many questions as you have sent to us. But Frank, one of the questions was, do you get more kids who ask about Lafayette or more where the initiative comes from you guys towards the football player?
Well, we do quite a bit in our own, obviously, by, you get seven people out on the road at one time, plus guys working back here. But, you know, that number's catching up to half of chasing you. And especially, again, through the prospect camps, which are something. We run five of those things in the summer, so people have preliminarily taken a look. You come here, work out of our prospect camp.
Yeah, we're seeing that more and more, Coach, attention. Where you've had a kid in camp or twice.
Right.
And you really like him.
Josh Davis came as a junior and a senior and wanted to make an early decision, and we moved. There were other quarterbacks
later. We'll
see
Josh later on, yeah.
When, you know, I'm comfortable when we made a decision. I think the young man's a perfect fit for our place, and I really like what he's doing. And then you look at his senior film. Some of that I didn't even see until after he was committed this year. You look at some of his senior film, and you're going to go, this is a great early decision for us. So, you know, we're learning as we go on. This is not, I'm only second year with handing out bags of money now. I'm kind of enjoying this, you know, after all those years, 37 years, or 36 years rather, handing out financial aid forms and asking for people's tax return. Mike knows that thing. Somebody asked it earlier about, you know, going to the playoffs, does that set you behind? Before, it would have with financial aid because there's so much paper. You lose a week of chasing down paperwork, Mike certainly
remember.
Yeah, it would set you behind, but with scholarships, you're already, you know what you're doing pretty much. So, yeah, there were a couple of people and names that came up late, and we were pretty much finished. There were a couple of people I wish I would have had something, but those things happen. I tell our staff all the time, you cannot recruit everyone.
Yeah, it's not a bottomless pit.
If you worry about the people that went elsewhere and spend more time on that than you do on the people you got, you have issues. So we're focused on the people that we were fortunate enough to get. Yeah. And did we lose good people to Lehigh? Sure. Yes. Did we lose good recruits to Colgate? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And a lot of other schools. But are we just really happy about this class?
Right. And it, a lot of it comes down to, as you and I both know, is how much time they spend on campus. Tell us about, maybe they're on campus, a little less than 48 hours, and now it belongs to your team. And how do they sell the team and food and dormitories and what do they do at night? And that's a big part of it.
Let me tell you, coaches spend a year, sometimes longer recruiting people. Nowadays, 2 years start so early. And you got a 48-hour period designated by the NCAA for them to be in your campus. Let me tell you, when they come here, we basically turn them over to the place. Now, we're fortunate. We have faculty spent an inordinate amount of weekends, actually every weekend past New Year's, plus several in December, on a Saturday coming in, talking to, and again, smaller groups now. It used to be two weekends with two larger groups. Now it's every weekend with small groups, and they readily do it. We didn't have one weekend when we didn't have an academic professor from an area of interest be here. All those things mean so much for the recruiting. But that's what makes Lafayette unique. This truly is a campus community where people care about one another, and we got a lot of living proof of that around here with, you know, people like myself who have kind of been here since the bricks were put in, and our faculty is the same way.
When you think about it, Frank, it may be the most critical piece. I mean, these kids, for the most part, are not kids with aspirations to play professional football. I mean, you've had a couple. But they're here to get a good education, and it's the faculty involvement, the student involvement, obviously the academics that I'm sure might be the biggest selling point.
It all has to work. I told all our recruits, you can ask any of the families sitting in my office on Sunday morning, sitting in their parents on the love seat, student athlete over here in his. I look the kid in the eye and tell him, I'm going to be all over you harder about your academics than I am on the field, because my first responsibility to your parents, and I always point to them over there, see that you walk across that stage 4 years later. I haven't missed a graduation. I've been to 28 of them now because I was at one when that group graduated during my first spring here. I hadn't even coached a season yet. And I've been fortunate enough to have three of those graduations be three of my own children graduate from this place.
And it may be the championships aside, maybe your greatest legacy will be the number of kids that make the All-Patriot League academic team. We have the Patriot League Scholar Athlete this year in
again.
Mark Ross. Again. And that's something you really have to be proud of.
We're extremely proud of that. Fourth in the country graduation rate. You see nice plaques around the corner here from the FCS ADs about progression toward, because we're very attentive to it, and you have to be. We change practices here. I tell other coaches around the country, I change practice because there's a speaker or there's career night, and you got to move practice to the night because the kids are tied up at regular practice time. That's just something you do here,
you live with,
because it's for, we're here for the kids, for their education, and to provide them with a championship program. I mean, we're, as you well know, it's intensity on and off the field.
Mike, I'm going to put you in a position many years ago when you probably had some hair.
Let's go. That only took 18 minutes.
That's okay, not Frank? Nice, Mike.
18 minutes, but okay, go ahead.
That's not nice. Guys.
You went through this day. I mean, it wasn't nearly the media explosion that it is now.
30 years ago,
you were sitting at home getting ready to sign a letter.
Yep.
Talk a little bit about how you felt that day, if you can recall.
Well, I tell you what, it's an amazing day for not only yourself, but for your entire family, because you go up and down. One day you're going to Lafayette, one day you're going. For me, it was the Naval Academy. I was committed to the Naval Academy, and I showed up at school that morning, signing day, or I think it was the day before signing day, and coach remembers Jim Collis and Spagnola, Coach Spagnola, who was a professional football coach, were in the parking lot. I opened the door, the two of them are standing there, and they're saying, "You're going to Lafayette, you're not going to Navy." And I said, "Well, no, I already committed to the Naval Academy." You know how the Naval Academy is, the 5 years after four and all that. So, you know, it was one of those things. By another 2 hours later, I was going to Lafayette College, and it really worked out. Now, 20 minutes down the road, a little close it was for me, but it was still nice that I could get my family here, and Coach talks about it. Having your family involved, not only in the decision, but to be here for every game I've ever played here at Lafayette College. So it was an interesting process, and it starts, like Coach said, it probably starts a little earlier now than it used to. It you know, started back in your junior year, but probably late May and June, you got started to get calls, you started to get letters, and then people would ask you where you're going to school, and you told them, "Well, I'm going to take your name." You only get five official visits, so that's another thing. You got to decide where you're going to visit and how important those schools are. Do you want to make two visits in one day? We used to do Lehigh Lafayette in one day. Some guys used to do that. Half a, you know, you try to get him in on a Friday at Lafayette, a Saturday at Lehigh. So, and I did that, and you know, visited Lehigh, visited Northeastern, had a full scholarship to go to Northeastern, Naval Academy, Bucknell. But Lafayette just felt right. And like Coach said, when you get on campus, a lot of those kids, you can see the smile come, the parents, they start, and especially nowadays when you look at the facilities we have here, it just feels right. You're there, you feel good, and then you start to spend, you know, you go up and eat in the dining hall, and now all of a sudden you're away from your parents, and you get a chance to open up a little bit and find out what it's like to maybe go down to the intramurals and play some hoops, and then get back and take a shower and come back to the room and find out what the kids do between classes, maybe attend a class, that type of thing. And then it's time to go out at night. What's the parties? What are the parties like? What do the girls look like? What are the guys like? What's the rest of the team like?
Really?
When do you guys go work out? I mean, these are all things that a 17-year-old, 18-year-old kid is thinking about. And they're probably thinking about those a little bit more than the others. You know, they're going to go through the economics tour, and they're going to go through, for me, it was the engineering tour, and they're going to look at all the pretty buildings, and then they want to find out, where's my locker, where am I going to play football, what number am I going to wear? That's another thing. You got to, you know, I wore 11 in high school, I want to wear it in college. You know, oh, somebody else has it. Those are a lot of things that go through these kids' minds. You wouldn't think that, but, and then it comes down to, obviously, financially. Back then, it was financial aid.
Right.
How much could the school offer you? Was it the same? Was another school giving you a little bit more? And then where do you feel comfortable? So for me, it came down to Lafayette College, and it was a great choice. And that was 30 years ago.
Wow.
You know, when Frank was here, my senior year, Coach Tavani came on as our running back coach, and we've been close ever since. So it's been a great ride. But this place is a special place, and I'm sure the 26 kids that are ready to sign here are found that out as well.
Well, let's talk in generalities about the 26. 14 on offense, 11 on defense, and a long snapper. Let's start with the long snapper. Obviously, a critical position on a football field that most people overlook.
Well, there's no question. And, you know, Mike Schiff, he had been at, I think, every prospect camp that we've had here since we started doing them. You know, just great people. And again, good local people. You know, Coach Schiffert's brothers, son, his nephew, you know, all good people.
Yeah.
And I think it's just something that I think, you know, he really wanted to be here, and whether or not that was going to happen or not, and whether, you know, people get involved. And certainly we were very serious about it. Sometimes you make those decisions a little later as you see how the class develops. But that's certainly a huge impact. And you know, he'll challenge. You know, he'll challenge for the position. He's that good. A lot of, I know Penn State and a few other schools, you know, wanted him to walk on and try to earn one. So, you know, he's that good. He's highly rated by those camps where they rate long snappers and those things. So it's a it's a very important part. The punt team is an extension of the offense because it it's change of field position, mm-hmm. but got to get the punt off, and it has to do with snap kick.
And so one of the games, Coach, we had two long snappers kind of go down. I remember Baker went down.
We had some
and
problems.
And then Morgan went down.
No doubt.
He got Coach McFadden there kind of holding on for
happen.
Dear
so
life.
You know, he's getting bigger now than he was. I mean, I remember this kid as a sophomore in high school. You know, he'd be down at their camps or whatever. They'd see him over in the back of the stadium working out on a Sunday, with his dad and everything. And just a tremendous work ethic and great kid. And the kind of kid, a leader type of kid, too, that you want on your football team.
Break down the offense. Four wide receivers, four offensive linemen, three tailbacks, two tight ends, and a quarterback. That's sort of takes care of every offensive area for you.
Well, you're trying to fulfill your needs. We know that we're going to lose three wide receivers coming up, so it was important to have certainly some talent there. You'll see some good height there. Let's find the next Mark Ross. I'm not sure where you do that for a guy that has. Was under recruited and went beyond what anybody thought he could do, but we thought he could do. He's a great kid, and but trying to replace that. The backfield depth I was concerned about. Marcellus decided not to utilize his redshirt year, so that changed that situation. The quarterback situation, we knew we were going to bring one in. We actually are still in the process of. That may be the one addition you may see in the next couple of weeks because of Zurich transferring. And, Zach Zweizig's still not medically clear.
Not right.
Oh, wow.
So that, I think, is looking more like, the end of a career. And I think he and I have spoken. So it's just one of those things. So, you could find yourself going into the season with three quarterbacks. Now, you have an ace in the hole with, Josh Simmons over there on defense. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Great athlete. And if you look at his Avon Old Farm film,
quarterback.
He was lighting it up. So, those are the things you do. I always have to laugh. We're down at Princeton, and I saw they must have had nine quarterbacks taking snaps pregame. And I look over, and Coach Fine's over there warming up with our three guys.
Throwing long toss, yeah.
Coach Fine might be playing in the spring game.
I said that to him before we went on the air.
If he plays in the spring game, Mike's going over at safety.
Well, last year's spring game, you only had two, remember? And also at the running back position, I would think Sherman's going to be in a little bit of a glass case.
Well, I venture to say that short of him being in a different color jersey, there's probably every reason to believe that
we won't see him, right?
Yeah, he'll be coaching right next to you.
Yeah, he might be coaching. I'm not sure what he'll be. But, it's a great time to develop those other people. Kyle Mayfield, I think is really ready to bust out. But you need that confidence. That's going to take a lot of reps, a lot of live reps. And he'll certainly get an opportunity to do that.
Yeah.
All right, defensively, four linebackers, four defensive backs, two defensive ends, and a safety. Your thoughts there?
Well, filling in the secondary, you're always looking for, true cover corners, and I think we have one that is, one that can be a corner and a safety, and the other guy probably more of a safety. So, we feel good, again, about filling in depth there, the linebacker pool. It was amazing when we took the little personnel magnets down and put them on my board in my conference room, and happened to be, they're color-coded, so these freshmen just happen to be red this year. And you just look at and you put them on the board, and what that's done to our depth. I mean, it's looked like it hadn't looked before we took the decline in numbers and the financial aid hurt us. Now the O-line is probably, I think there's 19 O-line. Because we recovered three O-linemen that were out last year.
Sure,
that
right,
come
right,
back. I mean, so those things really help you. And the depth situation is all about practice and preparation and guys getting ready when people get hurt, and that's the area I think you're going to see this class really solidifies our depth. So the next two recruiting classes is a little different, probably even go a little slower and look at it, because it's not going to be as immediate need of help as maybe it was before, and you can take your time and really zero in. So we've already begun the next cycle. People go, you take a week off, Yeah. A week off. Yeah. We've been 2 weeks into looking at juniors and sophomores already.
Absolutely.
I don't know how much film already we've looked at already. And now, of course, you know, I'll be also tied up in doing a search for a defense coordinator's position, and that'll take a little of my time. But the rest of the guys are already heavy into the next recruiting cycle.
We got another question from one of our viewers about whether you pay more attention to a kid as an athlete or as a position player.
Well, you're always, you know, interested in his athleticism. That's why you height, weight, speed, and all mm-hmm. those things you ask. But again, when you're zeroed in at a certain position, and you need that. But there have been a lot of kids who said, hey, next best guy on the board, and you're going to take the next best athlete. So it's kind of twofold. But, you know, there are those specific mm-hmm. needs that mm-hmm. you got to have. I mean, he's a great athlete, but he can't start at right guard.
Yeah.
You know,
now you've been,
if you really need a right guard, yeah. then you got to go get a, right,
get a
guard,
right guard
or two.
Right, right.
Yeah. Now you've been doing this is second year scholarships. Do you see a difference in the kids just athletically that you can talk to now, as opposed to the kids that a couple years ago you just couldn't even talk to that kid?
Well, first off, obviously. Just the kids you compete against with the Ivies,
yeah.
you couldn't even talk to them because they're going there, and if,
right.
even if your aid matched theirs, or in a rare instance it would be better, they'd just top it anyway. And
mm-hmm. right.
I can honestly say in all those years, never once do you win any head-to-head. You're not going to win those. But now, different story.
Yeah.
Kid doesn't qualify for anything, and he's a great football player, and you mm-hmm. offer him a half or a full, and he's going to pay full to go there. We're getting those kids. So they're feeling, yeah. Okay. Believe me, they're not taking on water. Their boat has some dents in it. We're making some dents in the boat, but
right.
that boat's not sinking. Trust me, we had a lot of kids pay full and turn down
yeah.
full.
Well,
there were two or three of those.
Okay.
So the turn down, you know, and just, you're
right.
gonna, well, I'm paying.
But some of the kids that you are recruiting, you're seeing them get
yeah.
some scholarships.
So you're seeing
from
that, mm-hmm. and you're seeing you have access to a better athletic kid, and especially
yeah.
kids that have strong academics that want both. There's kids that are being recruited by schools, and the families will tell you right out, they're not, you know, they're interested in the academics, and they want
right.
to, you know, they want to come to this type of school. So the Patriot League as a whole does well because of that. And Fordham is a perfect example of that.
And the more you're heading to the West Coast and seeing some of the kids from Arizona, Colorado, California, when you walk in, it's Lafayette College. They know Lafayette College. The Patriot League is becoming...
Well, if they don't know Lafayette College, they just have to know one thing, that you have a bag of scholarships available. That generally...
gets you in the door.
That gets them Absolutely. Real interested. If they don't, they'll research you online
right.
the minute you walk out of the building.
Right.
They're now a little interested. So,
yeah.
And most of them know ahead of time because, you know, when you're making these visits in the schools, you're not just walking in cold.
Right.
We're going in there for a reason. We know
mm-hmm.
something about somebody, and we're going, the coach knows you're coming
right.
in, and you know, the high school mm-hmm. coaches, they can say what they want, but they look at us as a conference is a lot different.
Yeah.
Hey, come on in, you know,
sure.
instead of we'll wait in line while the four right. scholarship skills are over here talking
right.
to my guy.
Now you're
because
in that
everybody
line.
Wants a scholarship. I mean,
right.
didn't we all? I did. Mm-hmm. I didn't get one.
Absolutely. I've been in Valley.
I wasn't a scholarship player. I was a financial aid and paid student loans for 10 years. $39.95 for 10 years.
You did all right.
It was a burden.
Yeah. It might be time for
But
a
you're
break.
A legend at Lebanon Valley.
Yeah, in my own mind. Hey, Lebanon Valley, I want you to know, I sponsored yes. Bruce Smith's, Kevin Smith's ring. They won the MAC and went
yep.
to the playoffs for the
nice
first
year.
Time, I think, and ever. And Kevin Smith worked for us here at our camp
mm-hmm.
for years
mm-hmm.
as a youth
mm-hmm.
kid. And know Bruce well, and they were selling T-shirts to get their rings. I said, how much is the ring? I said, you need an alumni sponsor like we do.
Oh, yeah.
So I sponsored the ring. So
overall,
I have a Lebanon Valley Championship T-shirt
very
now
nice.
To show for it, Mike.
Lebval, very nice.
And we can't wait to see that one, Frank. Overall picture, give yourself a great recruiting year.
Well, everybody's going to say, hey, it was a great recruiting
yeah.
year. I think to get the you know the true answer to that, you got to ask me 2 years from
yes.
now
okay.
after I've seen him as freshman and sophomore.
All right, yeah. let's look at last year.
I like the way it looks. Well, and
last year,
if you go at last year,
I
don't want to be perfect and go A+ or anything.
But it's
but
pretty good. Pretty good.
It's pretty right. good. I don't think it's perfect, but I don't think anything ever is. But you know, we felt strong, and I think it's
right.
It said that, so we got to be in. We got to be B+, A-.
Well, one thing you said last year that was perfect.
We're still learning.
Was
yeah.
your
yeah, I'm sure
your senior leadership last year? Does that carry over to the juniors this year? Do you have that same kind of feeling,
this
or do
group,
you have to wait
yes,
to kind
now,
of feel?
Yes, this group is part of that. They bought into that group as they went. And this senior group, and again, you've heard me say it over and over, I can't say enough about them as a whole, and they decided that things were going to be different. And it's like I said the other day, the team meeting, hey, I don't know, I'll never know whether things were that different socially and all those things, but all I know is we didn't have one incident where I got a call from the dean's office. Now, there were a couple minor things
that happened.
Yeah, it was just me. So, but nothing, no one going to disciplinary hearing, you know, none of that. Yeah. Because I think they were focused and those seniors wanted to leave with a championship, and I think the other kids wanted them to leave that way. And now headed up with guys like Justin Adams. What a tremendous leader he is. He's with our Oaks Leadership Academy. He was just down at the Naval Academy. He was selected here.
Wow.
He was in my office yesterday. I'm going, you know, this is why you do this. You're around these kids that are just terrific. You know, the Brad Bormans. I mean, I got to tell you, I don't know in 38 years, I got to say, I don't know if I've ever, and I don't think so.
Yeah, those are the kids that come back in your office 10 years from now, and you walk right in and sit down.
He's special.
Oh, absolutely.
Special kids.
Absolutely.
He's
so
all of
bright.
Us. Yeah.
I mean, you know, he uses words at the press conference. I got to go back and look them up. I mean, you know.
You need a thesaurus.
I think it's best when his teammate said what he said.
That was Pat Crosby's famous line, right?
Nobody wants to talk after Brad talks. And, you know, so that. And those are the kinds of kids that fortunately here at Lafayette, but really in the Patriot League, we're all fortunate enough to coach truly student athletes, and that's what it's all about. Somebody said, wouldn't you like to be getting one of those $3 million contracts? Well, you know, my bank would like it, but no. It's a deal.
Kids are special. Frank, I don't want to let
you get enough headaches now.
I don't want you to let you go without talking about one of your staff members who has left, and that's John Luce. I mean, so many years, a special place in all of our hearts because of the family, because of Lauren, and because of his commitment to Lafayette College, heading on to Army as an assistant coach. I believe probably every head coach expects his assistants, hopefully, to learn from that head coach and move on to greener pastures. But John really had a special place here for a number of years.
Well, no doubt about it. Again, I just said to somebody the other day, I'm looking for a defensive coordinator for only the second time since I took the job. and the first time was after I took the job. So that is very fortunate. We've been really fortunate in a lot of ways with staff here. My first original group, we were all together for 8 years. And then after you win 3 straight championships to go to the playoffs, in 1 year, 3 guys are gone, but they're all moving up. They're all doing better things. They get great opportunities. And, you know, this opportunity, things have changed tremendously since John's been there. It was a significant, you know, financial situation for him and his family. There's significant benefits, and not even to mention, you know, free housing and utilities and all those things. So it's a tremendous opportunity for him as a fan. Plus, moving up to FBS and, you know, some of the things that they're doing, these things, after a while, you got to look at those things. So I'm always happy for our staff. But as a head coach, it's the toughest thing all the time is personnel. Mm-hmm. And now sifting through resumes, we'll have an in-house applicant, and we'll go through that. And it's a national search. There's a committee. They'll interview and go through that. And I'm hoping over the next 2 weeks to tie that up and announce who's going to be taking over that position.
Great. Nobody else is doing this in the Patriot League today, so you're fortunate to be watching GoLeopards.com. And a reminder of what the day will have for you. At 1 o'clock, Mike and I will be back. We're going to talk about offensive players who were recruited. We'll show you some highlight film of those players, and Mike will give you an in-depth look at what those players may bring to Lafayette College. That's all at 1 o'clock. At 2 o'clock, we'll talk defense. Mike and I will be back for that. At 3 o'clock, Dr. Bruce McCutcheon will be here. We'll also talk to Ross Sherman, one of the outstanding running backs in the Patriot League. We'll chat with him a bit, and we will also highlight for you the recruits of field hockey, men and women's soccer. All of that's around the corner all day long, as this is signing day on GoLeopards.com. So for now, for Mike Joseph, for Frank Tavani, and for myself, I'm Gary Laubach. Thanks for spending this time with us. We'll see you again at 1 o'clock.